Hello, students. Good to see you all again. In this section, we are studying the difference in differences technique, usually shortened to just diff and diff. The reading for this section is section 5.2 in our text, mostly harmless econometrics. Remember, we are seeking an unbiased estimate of the effect of some policy or treatment, and we are worried about selection bias, as we are not running an experiment, but we're using observational data. We are especially worried about selection bias arising from unobservable factors that influence both the selection to treatment and the effect of the treatment. Diff and diff is designed to control for any possible factors, both observable and unobservable, that are constant over time. The basic idea is to have two groups, one that receives the treatment or is affected by the policy under study, and the other that is not. We also need data on the two groups before and after the treatment occurs. Diff and diff calculates the difference in outcomes between the two groups before treatment and the difference in outcomes between the groups after treatment. Then the difference between those two differences is the estimated effect of the policy or treatment. By only using the change in the difference between the treated and control groups to measure the effect of treatment, we effectively have removed any time invariant factors that might be associated with both the selection into treatment and the outcome of the treatment. This is true for both observable and unobservable factors. Let's take an example from a paper in the American Economic Review by Mayer, Viscusi, and Durbin. They want to study what effect increasing the generosity of workmen's compensation has on how long injured workers will stay in the compensation program and not work. They use a policies change in the state of Kentucky to get an answer to the question. Workmen's comp payments rise as a function of past earnings until some maximum level or cap is reached. In Kentucky, they raise the maximum level, which raises payments to high earners but doesn't affect lower earners. The authors take data on both high and low earners from before the change and after the change. Let me illustrate the policy change they study with a graph. Their low earner group are the workers whose benefits are unchanged by the policy, while their high earner group are those whose benefits used to be capped but are now increased. Before the policy change, the average duration of workman comp claims was 11.16 weeks for high earners and 6.25 weeks for low earners. That's a difference of 4.91. After the change, the average durations were 12.89 weeks for the high earners and 7.01 weeks for the low earners. That's a difference of 5.88 weeks. Subtract the first difference from the second one, and our diff and diff estimate of the effect of the policy is 0.97 weeks. The interpretation is that one effect of making workman's comp more generous for high earners is they spent an average of about one additional week away from work each time they made a successful workman's comp claim. Now, the low earners are not necessarily a valid direct control group for the high earners. They may differ possibly in experience, education, ability, and even motivation. So it's important to emphasize what we are not doing to measure the treatment effect. We are not simply using the difference between low and high earners in their duration of disability. That would run into all the issues of selection bias that we've been discussing. Nor are we simply using the change in high earner duration after the policy change. Diff and diff only uses the change in the difference between the two groups before and after the policy change to generate an unbiased estimate of the effect of the policy change. This seems fantastic, doesn't it? We can eliminate the effect of time invariant unobservables simply by studying the change in the difference between the treated and control group from before to after the treatment. Well, it kind of is. But there is one caveat. We haven't mentioned it yet, but we are implicitly assuming that the only thing that affects the gap between the treated and control groups is the policy we are studying. Everything else that is time varying must be affecting both groups the same way. We call this the parallel trends assumption. In other words, our counterfactual for what would have happened in the absence of the treatment is that the gap between the treated and control group would have remained the same. Let me illustrate with a graph. Let's put the outcome on the vertical axis and time on the horizontal. We can then fill in points representing the average value of the outcome before treatment for both the treated and control groups. Now let's fill in points for the average value of the outcome for the two groups after treatment. The difference between the outcomes post-treatment minus the difference between the outcomes pre-treatment is our measure of the effect of the treatment. We can illustrate parallel trends by connecting the two points for each group with a line and then also drawing another line for the treated group that starts at their before treatment point but is parallel to the line for the control group. This last line, the one with the same slope as the untreated line, is our counterfactual, as the difference between its endpoint and the actual endpoint of the treated group exactly represents the diff and diff estimate of the treatment effect. I can also illustrate why we need this assumption. Suppose the treated and control groups were on different trend paths before the treatment. I'll draw them so they are getting further apart. If those underlying trends continue during the treatment period, then the true treatment effect is zero, but the diff and diff method is going to give us a biased answer because it assumes the treated unit would have the same trend as the control in the absence of treatment. We will discuss how to examine this assumption in our subsection on reality checks for the diff and diff model. We can also use linear regression to estimate our diff and diff treatment effect and get standard errors and significance levels for the effect. Our dependent variable is the outcome we are studying. Let's call it y. In the example we've been discussing, y would be the number of weeks on workman's comp. We have to have observations on treated and untreated units before and after the treatment. So we will write yit, where I indexes the units, workers, states, counties, and t indexes time. We then create a treated unit dummy variable that equals 1 for the units that are in the treatment group and 0 for the units in the untreated group. Let's call it treat I. There's no t index because the variable does not change over time. In our previous example, this variable would equal 1 for the high earners and 0 for the low earners. We also need a time dummy variable that equals 1 in the treatment period and 0 in the pretreatment period. Let's call it time t. There is no I index here because time does not vary across the units. In our previous example, this variable would be 1 after the benefits cap was raised and 0 before it was raised. The exact form of the regression is as follows. Yit is equal to A plus B times treat I plus C times time t plus D times treat times time plus EIT, where EIT is the random error term. The coefficient D gives us exactly the difference in differences estimate of the treatment effect we get from doing the double subtractions that I've described above. Beyond this basic setup, researchers will often add time-varying control variables to the basic equation for things like weather, the state of the economy, or to model changing behavior due to the time of year, which we call seasonality. But the classic diff and diff effect can be estimated with just this simple regression.